build a strong 12. If you will not succeed in building your strong 12, everything will collapse. That's why a G12 pastor, before setting every infrastructure, first you need to build a strong 12. Everything depends on our primary 12. Okay? There's a saying that your being is more important than your doing. God is more interested for who you are than what you do. So, we need to understand that your being is more important than your doing. That's why we're called human being, not human doing. Can you imagine that? Who are you? You are human doing, not your human being. Before giving your primary 12 specific tasks or roles, be sure we need to establish their identity. Okay? So I'll give you preliminary points before going to the role of the primary 12. When you are building your strong primary 12, how to build it? How to do it? Number one, change their mindset. That's the first thing you need to do in building your primary 12. Change their mindset. Change the way they think. Most people, before they were born again, their mindset is so worldly, so secular, opposite to what the Bible is saying. That's why the best way to change the way they think is by confronting their mindset with the Scripture. Amen. That's why every pastor should have this deep grasp on the Scripture, so that you can deal their negative, defective mindset using the Word of God. Why is that? You cannot change the way they live until you change the way they think. Because you are what you think. The way you live is just a byproduct of your mindset. That's why the Bible is saying to us, be renewed by the transforming of your mind. If you cannot change the way you think, you cannot change the way you live. Therefore, before expecting the primary 12 to change the way they live, you need to change the way they think. Right? Right? Left. Okay, number two. Number one, change the way they think. Change their mindset. Number two, heal their self-esteem. Most people, especially in the third world countries, their self-esteem or self-worth is very, very low. Some people suffer from inferiority complex, lack of self-confidence. How God can use somebody who has very low self-esteem? No confidence at all. God can use a discouraged person. Right? That's why the Bible keep on saying to us, do not fear. Be confident. If you are not confident enough about yourself, about the way you look, about the way you look, how God can use you? So, heal their self-esteem or self-worth. I read a story long ago about a person, a man, saw a motorcycle, dilapidated old motorcycle, and he bought that junk motorcycle and he bring it to his place. After a few minutes, somebody called him. Are you the one who bought the motorcycle? Yes, I am. Well, my boss is trying to wants to buy that old motorcycle. What? I bought it for $45. It's a chump. Yes, my boss wants to buy that motorcycle for $500. Are you crazy? A chump? I bought for $5. You will buy it for $500? Okay, name your price. How much? You want $5,000? $500,000 US dollars? Are you serious? Well, before we we make a discussion about the motorcycle. Will you please look at underneath the seat of the motorcycle if you can find something underneath? Then the guy looked at the underneath of the motorcycle and he found an inscription. And this inscription says, "The King." The King. Meaning the owner of that old, dilapidated motorcycle is the King. The late Elvis Presley. What's the point? The value of the motorcycle is not based on his past, not based on his appearance, but based on who is the owner. Your self-worth is not based on your past, not based on the color of your skin, but who owns you? Who owns you? If you believe that you are God's property, it's enough for us to build self-confidence. We need to have that healed emotion. Heal their self-esteem. Instead of running your life based on emotion or based on what you feel, you need to run your life based on biblical principle. How many of you believe that emotion is not reliable? Emotion changes from time to time. Therefore, emotion is unreliable. When you see a beautiful, gorgeous girl, you like it. You are attracted. When you see a more beautiful girl, then you change your mind. You pursue another girl. Because, again, emotions change from time to time. And this is it. Your emotion is you. Your emotion is you. If you are lonely, don't say, "Well, I'm not lonely. It's my emotion that's lonely." You can say that because your emotion is you. Right? Right? Left. If you are angry, don't say, "I'm not angry. It is my emotion that is angry." You can say that because your emotion is you. Amen. That's why if you allow your emotion to control your life, you can go nowhere. God cannot use you if you operate based on what you feel. Instead of running your life based on what you feel, run your life based on God's word. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will remain. The best way to heal self-esteem is by using the scripture in discipling people. Okay? Number three, awaken their leadership potential. Everyone has potential. But that potential from the inside of you should be released. That's why we need to keep on encouraging people. You know, you can be a leader. You can do something for God. You can do it. Constant encouragement, training will awaken people's leadership potential. You have potential, but the problem, that potential is inside of you. There's a giant inside of you, but that giant is sleeping, right? But the moment that giant being awakened, rise up and stand, can you imagine what a giant can do? The moment that giant was awakened. You need to change the way you look at your disciples. Look at them not based on their past, but look at them what God can do in them and through them. Amen?
Yes.
When you look at David, the boy David, what God can do with this boy David? But there's something inside of David that's lacking from the Israelite. That's why what divided the successful and unsuccessful is how you look at yourself. To build your strong primary wealth, awaken their leadership potential. There's something inside of them that must be released by constant encouragement. Number four, mold their character. Mold their character. Can you imagine to have a competent, skillful primary 12, but when it comes to character, they have less of character flaws? That's why you need to confront their character flaws. Primary 12 must not only people of competence, but person of character. Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Sa Tagalog, hindi lang dapat mabait, dapat mahusay. Hindi lang dapat mahusay, kundi mabait.
Anong speaking tongues?
Mold their character. Number five, plant the vision in their hearts. Plant the vision in their hearts. If you accomplish 1 to 4, but you failed in number 5, they can use by God in gathering the multitude. The secret is you need to plant the vision in the hearts, meaning to winning souls and making disciples is their lifestyle. It's the very heartbeat of every primary 12. That's why we believe the primary 12 should be a sort of winning machine, soul winning machine. Soul winning must be a lifestyle. It must come natural. I believe there's no such thing as evangelistic week or evangelistic month. Evangelism must be a lifestyle. So the vision is about winning soul and making disciples. What's the difference between a man and a woman? Spell it. Woman and man. Difference. Two words make them different. The word W and O. The difference between a woman and a man is woman possesses reproductive organ. Man, we have tummy but does not reproductive organ. Don't you know that church is woman?
Yeah, that's word.
Yes, ecclesia. In Greek language, when the word ends in E or A, it's feminine. When it ends in OS, it's masculine. For example, anthropos. We get the word anthropology from the word anthropos, is masculine. Adelpos is masculine. Cosmos, the world, is masculine. For example, the word aletheia means truth. It's feminine. Church is ecclesia. Meaning church is feminine. If the church is feminine, it's the bride of Christ. Therefore, church possesses reproductive organ. Right?
Yes.
You got it. And what is the reproductive organ of the church? Evangelism. I don't care if your woman possesses 10 reproductive organs, but that reproductive organ is not activated, it's useless. The church has the potential to grow and multiply and expand by evangelism, but if you will not utilize that spiritual reproductive organ, the church will remain small and minority. The church is called to grow and multiply. Every church, regardless of the kind of church you have, every church has the potential to grow. But the question is, are you utilizing that spiritual reproductive organ? So the moment you plant the vision in the hearts of your primary 12, you are building a soul-winning machine. Right? so that you can change the way they live, heal their self-esteem. They need to look at themselves, how God looks at them. Awaken that sleeping leadership potential. You need to believe in your disciple. Mold their character and competition. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Look at the first letter of your point. When you have done that, you feel charmed. Okay, 4 things. All word about the primary club. Number 1 is character. It's about attitude. Character is about attitude. They must be a maturing people. They need to mature. It's okay to select people that are immature at the start. But as you go on discipling them, be sure every one of them is maturing. You are building their character. Or character. Character is about attitude. Somebody asked me, what is maturity, Pastor? What is maturity? We need to raise mature leaders. What is maturity, by the way? Okay, maturity has nothing to do with your age. There are people that have grown up, and yet, when you look at the way they act, the way they react, so it's immature. Therefore, the problem is not your age. The problem is your character or your maturity, immaturity. So maturity has nothing to do with your age. Maturity has nothing to do with your education. There are lots of people that are so educated, and yet when they live their life, in a very immature manner. And number 3, maturity has nothing to do with your accomplishment. Maturity has nothing to do with what you have accomplished. If maturity has nothing to do with your age, has nothing to do with your education and with your accomplishment, therefore, what is maturity? Maturity is about attitude. You can say a person mature or immature based on their attitude, how they react in certain circumstances, how they react towards problems, how they react towards conflict, how they react towards challenges in life. You can see a mature person during conflict, problem, and pressure. Look at the person beside you. Is the person mature or aging or maturing? Lots of people are just aging, but they are not maturing. I call it a 50-year-old baby. 50-year-old baby. Maybe the person beside you is 50 years old, but in fact, the way they, when they act, when they react, very mature. So, number 1, it's a PowerPoint. Character. Number 2, confidence. Competence. Character is not enough. You cannot grow your church by being a person of character. Church don't grow because people are kind. We gather the multitude not because we are kind. We gather multitude because not only the first people are character, but they are skillful, meaning they are competent. These two must be combined. You need to look at person who are person of character and person of competence, just like David. With his skillful hand, he led Israel. That's why character is not enough. You need to develop competence. You need to be trained. You need to be skillful in doing the vision. Right? Somebody said, if you want to go to the top, you need confidence. But to remain at the top, you need generation to fail, teach them competence before you teach them character, that they're on the way to failure, right? Okay, number three, courage. Why courage? Okay, listen to this. Every virtues are useless without courage. Think about that. Every virtues are useless without courage. You speak fluently, you speak dynamically, but if you don't have courage, you will not dare to speak. So what's the use of your that virtue without courage? You're so gorgeous and beautiful. Your beauty is for a beauty contest, but you don't have courage, you will not join the beauty contest. What's your beauty if the brain is empty? Right? Courage. When Goliath is challenging the people of God for a battle, no one dares to take the challenge of Goliath. Why? Everyone is fearful. But here comes David, the young boy David. The difference between the Israelites and David is their perspective. The Israelites look at Goliath as the champion, the nine-footer giant, wearing full battle gear. That's the way they look at David. That's why when they look at Goliath that way, they become fearful. But here comes David. And he said, he never said, you're champion, unbeatable giant. No, no. When David looked at Goliath, how does he look at Goliath? I think you need a doctor. Uncircumcised Philistine. The same giant, the same Goliath, but different perspective. Perspective matters a lot. How you look at things. Don't you know that we look at things not as they are, but who we are? We look at things not as they are, but who we are. In the Philippines, when Filipinos in the jungle see a very big tree, they can see ghosts, dwarves, big palam, and sort of that is. That's why they're so fearful. Tangalico, right, Filipinos? But when an American see a big tree, what he can see? Money, white furniture, number. We look at things not as they are, but we look at things for who we are. You need to change your spiritual lens. Start to change the way you look at things. Be courageous. Right? All virtues are useless without courage. A fearful person is a loser even before he started. Why? A fearful person will not dare to start. A fearful person will not start anything. That's why a fearful person is already a loser before he fights. God cannot use a fearful person. That's why in the book of Joshua chapter 1, one of my favorite books in the scripture, in the Bible, is the book of Joshua. Because the book of Joshua is a book of war. It's about the mission of God. It's about the book of conquest. So if you want to discover how to become a courageous person, look, read the book of Joshua. In chapter 1 of Joshua, three times said, Moses said to Joshua, be strong and be courageous. say to a person, don't have fear, or be courageous. You need to give a reason why they need to be courageous, right? Don't fear. Why? Give me a reason why I'm not that. Give me a reason why I should not be fearful. The book of Joshua realized three things, three reasons why every leader must not be fearful. Number one, because people are following. Joshua, if you demonstrate a fear before the people, they will also be discouraged. Because we are the ones setting spiritual temperature. You cannot expect people to be excited when the leader is not excited. Right? One time there's a boy, Sunday morning, awakened by the mother. Hey son, wake up. Mom, why are you waking me up? I want to sleep more. You need to wake up. Mom, I want to sleep more. Wake up! All right, Mom, give me a reason why I need to wake up. Son, today is Sunday. It's about church.
Wake up.
All right, another reason. We're Christians. We need to set an example for the neighbor. Christians should go to church every Sunday. All right, okay. Number three, the last reason why I need to go to church. You're the pastor of the church. Wake up. Don't expect people to be excited about God, about the reason of the leader. It's not excited. We produce our own kind. That's why discipleship is about modeling. Discipleship is duplicating. It's about carbon copying. You produce your own kind. You duplicate your strategy, your passion. You duplicate your spirituality to your people. It's about imitation. Courage. Every primary church should be courageous, because you cannot dare to invite people, to win people, to disciple people, to open yourself if you lack courage. Now, the reason why I can stand before you is not because I'm good at speaking. As you can observe, now I'm suffering from stuttering. I have a speech impediment. The reason why I can stand before you is Bishop Oriel told me to stand. I have a choice. And number two. Courage does not mean you are not fearful. Courage is about overcoming your fear. Number four is challenge. Every primary 12 should have that courage to face every challenges of the vision. The moment you embrace the vision in your life, you are facing different challenges in your life. For example, challenge number one, can you change the way you live? Many people don't have the courage to change their life. Now, changing life requires courage. Dreaming requires courage. Facing your current reality requires courage. That's why when you do the vision of winning souls and making disciples, you need to be courageous, because you're facing challenges. I think the reason why you came here, because you take the challenge of $1,000. That's your challenge. Can you come to the training? Yes. Well, you need to spend $1,000. It takes courage to come to this place. It's not free, right? Challenge. You see, challenge entails pressure. No pressure, no challenge. Because a challenge is called a challenge if it is difficult. It requires sacrifice. If something is easy, it's not challenging. Challenge becomes challenge because it is beyond your capacity and ability. For example, can you complete your cloud? Yesterday, there's people talking about building your cloud. Somebody said, well, I can only have 3. God is so much. Challenge. Completing the cloud is a challenge. I have a friend. I shared to him the vision of G12, and he said, well, God is so much. Maybe I will. Instead of 12 disciples, maybe I will just build my Peter, James, and John. That's enough. Just 3. But that person don't have the courage to complete the prayer. So challenge entails pressure. Say pressure. Pressure. Potential is being released in an atmosphere of pressure. Have you tried grape juice? Grape juice. Where does it come? From the grape. How? You put pressure on the grape, then the juice comes out. The more pressure you apply, the more juice will come out. Talk to the person beside you. Ask, tell him or tell her, you are juicy. You are juicy, especially this guy. So juicy. You put them on, you're so juicy. What a big grape you are. Potential is being released in an atmosphere of
pressure.
Many people avoid pressure.
Number two,
Invitation of guests, engagement in new services, marketplace couples, and Sunday service. The word is invitation. God is a God who invites. That's the nature of God. He keeps on inviting people. As disciples, we're created in the image of God. Therefore, invitation should be our value system. This is the principle. Sir, can I give you 5 points regarding invitation? Okay. How to grow your church? Okay, put the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One, how to grow your church? How to grow your church effectively? Okay, put the number. I'll give you the list. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Number one, invitation. Number one is invitation. Church grow when people invite their friends and neighbor, right? Invitation. This is the principle. The more you invite, the more people will come. If you invite few people will come. If you will not invite, nobody will come. Church grows because of invitation. There is a rule of seven about invitation. Rule of seven in invitation says, before you give up a person, you can give him up after seven no. Seven no before you give up. It requires persistence. How many of you are proud of you got born again because somebody invited you? As a product of an invitation. My friend named Carlito Palileo Jr., 1979, keep on inviting me. Without this friend, I cannot teach you. You cannot meet this handsome dog bug guy. Invitation. Church grow by invitation. That's the way to grow the church. Okay, number two is invitation. Number two, put it chronologically. Number three, invitation. Write it down, maybe you will forget this. Number four, invitation. And number five, last. And don't miss number five, very important also, invitation. We need to develop the culture of invitation in our church. Okay? So, go back. All right, copy this. Copyright. Don't miss the point. It loses power. Okay. Back to the original. The original PowerPoint. Okay? Invitation. Number three, engagement in consolidation. Okay. Winning soul and making disciples. Don't you know that you can learn discipleship if you can learn consolidation, because consolidation is discipleship 101. Every disciple must learn how to consolidate. If you will not learn how to consolidate, you will not learn how to disciple, because somehow consolidation is discipleship. This is the initial practice of discipleship. Engagement on consolidation. That's why every new leader should learn, should practice basic ministry skills. Those are devotion, invitation, evangelism, and basic consolidation. Those are basic ministry skills for new leaders. And consolidation is very crucial. Look at this. Our strategy is win, consolidate, disciple, and serve. Look at the place of consolidation in the ladder of success. Win, then consolidate, then disciple. What bridges winning to discipleship is consolidation. It doesn't matter if you have lots of people being won to Christ, but if you cannot bridge them to discipleship through consolidation, you can produce disciples. You get that point? Again, what bridge winning to concept of discipleship is consolidation. That's why consolidation is very, very crucial. Can I ask you a question? Is it possible that you are good in winning, but your church is not growing? The church who are good at consolidation is the church that will grow. Because consolidation is about initial lessons, initial practice of spiritual parenthood. God's mandate to Adam and Eve is go and multiply. What does it mean to go to go and multiply? Somebody said, well, go and multiply means they give birth to lots of babies. Right? Wrong. What if Eve keep on giving birth to babies every day? But they don't have that skill to become parents, well, all babies will die. Multiplication to that next place. That's why consolidation is about preserving the new convert. That's why I believe the best way to preserve people, the best way to close the back door of the church is by consolidation. Because through consolidation, you are making the step of new believers solid. You make their steps in Christ solid. That's why it's called consolidation. Okay? If you are not solid, you are gas. Number four, 6 month target for encounter. May I make some comments on the encounter? Okay? Maybe some of you are still doing this. There are cheaper churches conducting encounter because there's delegates available. But what if there's no any more delegates for the encounter in your church? You stop doing that encounter. What you need to do is to set an encounter date. And the question is, where's the delegate? You produce the delegate. That's why everyone in the church has goals. The pastor has goals. The primary goal has goal. Every cell has grown goal. Every member of the cell has grown goals. You get that? You set an encounter day that every cell will produce the delegates. Okay. Number five, engagement, my network in Pepsol training. Everyone in the church should bring everyone in the process of Pepsol training. Again, remember, our goal is to make every believer a leader of leaders by undergoing the process. You can't produce leaders by dancing. You cannot produce leaders by singing or by eating or by swimming or by concert. The only way to produce leaders is by bringing them in the process. Even praying for a person cannot make him a leader. For example, if you have a new believer, keep on praying to the new believer. I pray in the name of Jesus. Be a leader even right now, miraculously. Be a leader! What will happen? Still a member. Or maybe you will add 90 days fasting to your prayer. Doesn't make a person a leader. A leader becomes a leader because he underwent training. We produce cell group leaders. That's why Pepsol is about producing cell group leaders. That's why a wise cell group leader brings his people in the training to multiply his or her cell. Okay? Engage in Pepsol training. Okay, 17 minutes and 3 hours left. Number 6. Raising and empowering new cell leaders to open new cells. That's why the goal is not to grow, it's not only to grow your cell, but to multiply cells. told you that we need to produce not just sales, but we need to produce healthy, growing, and multiplying cells. You need to give birth to cells. You need to establish your 1 or 4 level. That's why the perspective should be, you need to constantly remind your leaders that you are not just a leader of 12, but you are a leader of 1 or 4. Don't just complete your 12, build your 1 or 4. That's why the perspective should be 1 or 4. And the stepping stone is 12. I am a leader of 1 or 4. I will build 1 or 4, but for the meantime, I will complete my 12. And you can observe, you can see, 12 is very easy if your perspective is 1 or 4. Okay? Bring. It doesn't matter if you have 50 people in yourself, but yet, if they are not undergoing the training, you cannot produce leader. Number 7. Target number of people to be engaged in training. Okay, number 8, target number of people to be engaged in mentoring, seminars, and convention or conference. You're old enough to understand this. Number 9, I want to give you this. Number 9, involving my network in paying our tithes for a regular meeting. Listen to me. A stingy church cannot grow. Only generous church can grow. The problem is not your earning. The problem is our spending. Are you investing for the kingdom? Are you investing for the mission? You cannot afford to become stingy. You cannot afford. It's hard to understand the waste of vision and yet you are not generous. I observe every digital churches, they are so generous. They're not just giving their money, they're giving their wallets. And number 10, my network involvement in our church services. Every disciple should support every church activities. Number 11, management goals. 10 and 11 and 12 goes together. You have goals. How to reach your goals? Strategize. Goal is about what you want to accomplish. Strategy is about how will you accomplish what you want to accomplish. That's why plan plus implementation is equivalent to result. Plan, goal, plan, plus strategy is equivalent to results. Vision is not enough. You need to have course of action. You need to have steps, plans. You need to strategize your vision. Vision is about what God wants you to do. Strategy is how will I do it? So vision without action is just an illusion. But vision plus action creates revolution. Illusion or revolution? Choose. That's why Jingle is not for lazy people. It requires hard work. Dreaming is free, but if you start to fulfill your dream, you will pay. So hope that we will build strong 12 in our churches. The key is the 12. If I'll give you an airplane without a key, you cannot fly an airplane. If I'll give you a mansion without a key, you cannot go inside the mansion. Key, very small piece of metal, but can do a lot of work. The way to gather the multitude is by building primary 12. Okay, let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for entrusting to us our disciples, our primary 12. We pray for them, Lord God. Equip them, develop their pastor and continue to change the way they think. We pray that they will start to think biblically, they start to think, Lord God, according to your plan and according to your purpose. Thank you so much, Lord. We're so excited about our future, what we can do through our primary 12. In Jesus' name.